Hey, what's up everybody? This is your favorite homeboy. And today, we're gonna talk about how to evaluate different Airbnb markets. Some of you may be watching, and specifically you're watching this because you're interested in the Poconos. But there may be some of you who are watching and you may be thinking about, you know, maybe you wanna invest in the Smokey Mountains or someplace near Disneyworld or Pensacola Beach, which is where we thought about investing because we really like Pensacola Beach. So how do you evaluate the differences between one area over another and what's more desirable? And that's something that I've been wrestling with for a good part of a year. This is kind of my hobby. I like investigating different Airbnb markets. So I've come up with a score. I'm going to call it the EdBNB score. So if you're interested in knowing what criteria I use to judge different vacation rental markets and the desirability and the investability of each market compared to one another, stay tuned to the rest of this video so you can learn about the EdBNB score. Okay. The first criteria that you want to pay attention to when you're looking at an Airbnb market is drivability. I'm defining drivability as proximity to a major MSA, a 5-hour proximity to be exact. Why 5 hours? Well, I mean, these days you can fly and be anywhere, but more and more, especially in this day and age of the pandemic and people are avoiding airplanes and travel and wanna keep things simple, driving has its benefits. I'm gonna include a link in the comments below to a map that shows, I think it's like the 25 or the 50 largest MSAs. And you can go on this map and you can see that one of the MSAs might be Austin or Houston or San Antonio. So these are large metropolitan statistical areas. So 5 hours from a major city center, basically. So that's gonna be part of the evaluation because the closer you are to access to people driving to your location as a vacation rental, that's gonna benefit your investment. To get a score of 5, which is gonna be the highest, we're gonna score all these criteria out of 1 to 5. To get a score of 5, you have to be 0 to 2 hours, meaning 0 hours, maybe your Airbnb is in the city, or you know, up to 2 hours. Up to 2 hours is a perfect mix where you can go down to your Airbnb for a day, easy, and return back for your own personal use. And it's easily a weekend trip. In fact, if it's 0 to 2 hours, it's going to be a score of a 5. If it's 2 to 3 hours, you get a score of a 4. If it's 3 to 4 hours, you get a score of a 3. To me, 3 to 4 hours one way is about the limit for a day trip. I mean, I remember when my mom used to go to New York City to visit her mom. When she was getting older, she'd visit her. That's like almost a 4-hour trip. Round trip, it's 8 hours. And she would do that in a day. And she took me once and I was like, man, mom, how do you do this every week? If you know my mom, she's an animal. So she would drive 4 hours one way, 4 hours back. To me, that's the limit. You tell me, comments below, what is your limit for a day trip one way? For me, it's probably 2 or 3 hours. 4 hours is a little bit much. So that's a score of a 3. To get a score of a 2, that's about a 4 to 5 hour trip, because any more than that is now like a weekend getaway. And then 5+ hours would be a score of a 1. Okay, so it's really easy to determine proximity to the major MSA. All you have to do is click on the link in the comments. It'll bring you up the map of the major MSA. For example, you can take Glacier National Park and you can go to Google, you can type in Glacier National Park, find where it is on the map, and then you compare it with this major MSA map on the link below and find out what major MSAs highlighted in these colors are closest to it. So you just go to one of these colors, you can zoom in, for example, Seattle. You go to Seattle, you go to the graph on the right, you line up the number, you can hit the magnify button and it'll show that it's Seattle. Okay, that's probably the closest one visually. So you can just go to Google Maps and see how far is, for example, Glacier National Park to Seattle. And in this case, it's showing over 8 hours to Seattle. So Glacier National Park in this example would be rated a 1 because it's over 5 hours. Whereas the Poconos, it's very drivable to many multiple MSAs. And so within 2 hours easily. So that definitely gets a score of a 5. All right, so that's the first criteria, drivability. The second criteria is demand. And I'm going to define demand. And it kind of goes hand in hand with this whole MSA idea because demand is defined as the size of the MSA within a 5-hour drive. The supply is the vacation rentals and the demand is the population that has access to it. I mean, if you're close to an MSA and there's only a million people in it, that's quite a big difference than being close to a major MSA that has 20 million people in it. So I'm defining a perfect score of 5 as having 5 hours drivability to over 20 million people. So some examples of that would be the Poconos, Killington, Vermont, which we're going there in a few months, so I'm interested to check out that place. Mammoth, California. These are some examples, 5 hours drive to a major MSA that has at least 20 million or more people. Multiple MSAs, in fact. A score of a 4 would be 5 hours drive to 10 to 20 million people. A few examples of that would be the Smoky Mountains, Disneyland, Orlando, and Austin. Okay, so you get the point, right? So basically, once you figure out what MSAs are close within a 5 hours drive, you can go look up the population. And I'm gonna include a link also in the comments section below. You go to Wikipedia, and it'll show you the 2019 population for that major MSA. So it's really easy to just look this information up. To get a score of a 3, that's 5 to 10 million people. A score of a 2, that's 1 to 5 million people. Unfortunately, that's where Pensacola is, not close to a lot of major people, but it's a score of a 2, Pensacola. My beloved Pensacola, love that place. I wish it scored higher there. And then of course, a score of 1 would be less than a million people. You might have the greatest place on earth, but if only less than a million people can drive there within 5 hours, good luck. You better be counting on a lot of airplane traffic and just the one-off people who are doing the road trips. So drivability, right? Demand is number 2. The third D, DINERO, the money. The money has to be a part of this equation. This is probably the toughest criteria to find out because you can't just look it up, right? You have to do a little bit more deeper digging, talk to a local real estate expert and to vacation rental owners and managers, that type of thing. So I'm going to define DINERO because it's hard to compare returns in different price brackets. So for my intents and purposes, I'm gonna be looking at an investor return for a $400,000 to $600,000 unit. So that way you can compare apples to apples. You can pick your budget, maybe it's 200 to 300, and compare that return across different markets. For me, it's a unit between 400 to 600,000. Because I'm not just buying some tiny little rental here, I'm buying a vacation rental and I want a big one. I want one that can fit at least 16 people, accommodate large parties so that whether it's in a downturn and I want to put a small family in there, I can. Or if the economy is great, I can accommodate a large party, multiple families at once. Okay, so DINERO, score of a 5, perfect score. You're making over 20% every year return. This is cash on cash return. So whatever money it takes to acquire that property, that $400,000 to $600,000 unit, I'm gonna make 20% of that back in 1 year, which means in 5 years, I've made up the entire money that I've put into the house, at least the initial down payment and closing costs. So for me, that'd be great. If I can take all my money back out in 5 years and repeat the process, to me, that's a score of a 5. Score of a 4, 15 to 20%. That's where I'm thinking my Poconos property is gonna lie, somewhere in the 15 to 20%. Some of you have asked what my numbers look like, and I'll be getting to that in a future video once I complete the year 2020. All right, so stay tuned for that. A score of a 3 is 10 to 15%. Still very good, very respectable, better than the stock market, better than a long-term rental, really. A score of a 2 is 5 to 10%, which is still better than some stocks and probably where long-term rental return rates lie in kind of the level 2. And then a score of a 1 is 5% return or less. Not worth the risk. Unless you're using this vacation rental for your personal enjoyment, then I would say, you know, it's not worth it if you're strictly looking at it just as an investment. Hey, if you wanna buy a vacation rental because you want a place to go, your own private place and enjoy it for your family and you don't care so much about the return, hey, why not? All right, so those are the three D's, right? Now, the fourth criteria doesn't start with a D because I wasn't creative enough to think of one. Maybe you can help me out with that. But this is called fun factor. No one's gonna go to a place, a vacation rental market, that's not fun. They wanna have fun, right? So it's gotta be fun. And I had to define this as the amount of things to do, to see, and has a good amount of things to eat, has a good food scene. And ideally, it's great for adults and children. And so a perfect score, a 5 and a 4 is gonna be a place that's great for adults and children. It's great for families, or it's great just for kids. If you just want to have your kids have fun, or adult gatherings, it's both. A 5 and a 4 is both. But a 5, what makes a 5 different than a 4, there's at least 2 seasons. So pretty much you can enjoy this place and you're gonna get traffic in the winter and the summer. Like for the Poconos, you've got skiing in the winter, in the summer you got hiking, you got a lot of summer activities, and there's good restaurants. Or if it's only 1 season, you have to compensate the fact that it's only a 1 season place, like maybe a beach. You know, not many people go into the beach in the winter time. But if there's year-long activities, like lots of indoor activities, then hey, that could kind of compensate for the fact that it's only 1 season. Also, you have to have great restaurants just to kind of compensate for the fact that it's so limited to that 1 season. These are just kind of arbitrary criteria. So let me know in the comments below if you can help me polish this up a little bit. So of course, I'm gonna give Poconos a score of a 5 because you have the 2 seasons and the food is decent. It's not the greatest, but it's decent and it's good enough, right? So I'm gonna give Poconos a 5. I'm gonna give Pensacola a 4. Because it is good for adults and kids, so it's still in the 5 and 4 range, but it's only a 1 season type of place, being a beach location. Now, the 3 and 2 scores are similar, but it's only for adults or kids. It doesn't have to be friendly to both adults and kids. So you're gonna be limiting your audience. So for example, Las Vegas. I know some of you think
Las Vegas has a lot of kid-friendly places, circus, whatever.
But look, I've been to Las Vegas with my kids, and I've had a cover their eyes because there's like naked ladies on cards thrown on the streets, little ticket stubs. So no, it's not kid friendly. So I would say Las Vegas is either a 3 or 2. What makes it a 3 versus a 2? Same thing. If it's multiple seasons, you can extend the rental period, it has excellent food and restaurants, which Las Vegas does, it's gonna be a 3. But it's not gonna crack into the 4 and 5 for fun factor because it's limited in its audience. Reno, maybe that's a 2. It's kind of like a smaller Las Vegas. Food is not as great, maybe. Entertainment value is just a notch less. I don't know. You tell me. I haven't been there in a long time. 1 would be a place, limited activities, mediocre restaurants, or none, like the Bonneville Salt Flats. I'll post a picture here. And you can see, I mean, it's a beautiful place to visit, but I don't know if I would stay there. And if I had an Airbnb near there, I'd probably get bored really quick. So, fun factor is the last factor. And the 5th bonus criteria, I don't have one. Maybe you can help me come up with a 5th bonus criteria. You know, I was thinking instead of fun factor, maybe I can have relax factor. But whether someone can relax or not, whether it's in a big city or out in the mountains, you know, that's gonna be so variable. And what does being in a big city have to do with being less rentable or less desirable as a rental investment? So I couldn't really use relax factor. I really couldn't link that to the investability of a location. So I'm having trouble thinking of a 5th criteria. So if you have a 5th criteria, comment below. Let me know what you think could be a 5th criteria of the EdBNB score. You can help me come up with this score. So to kind of sum it up here, if we were to rank the Poconos, because that's the only place I have personal experience, drivability, we said it was a 5. The man is a 5. DINERO is a 4, and fun factor is a 5. So that is a score of 19 out of 20. So if you can beat that, let me know. Put in the comments and tell me why you think your vacation rental market can beat the Poconos. I think the Poconos is one of the best places to invest if you're interested in vacation rentals. That's why I'm investing there. But if you have another option, I'm definitely open to it. All right, well, thank you so much for watching as I roll out my EdBNB score. I was really thinking about this for several months because I wanted to come up with criteria that was somewhat measurable, but then not everything is scientific, like the fun factor. And so trying to define that is kind of tricky. But I hope you enjoyed this, and I'd love it if you applied this to a vacation rental market other than the Poconos. I'd love to see the differences. If you're in the Poconos and you came up with a different score, let me know why. Try to prove me wrong. I'd love to hear it. And if you have any other questions or comments, please comment below. Please give me a thumbs up if you like the score. And if you want more videos like this, please subscribe. This is your favorite homeboy, signing out.